My name's Jeremy Gines. I'm the lead engineer on the Quix exoskeleton project. We've had a few major hurdles when we received all of our components and began to assemble them. Just a few slight tolerances that weren't quite met, where we had to file down a few edges so that we could assemble the carbon parts onto the machined components. We had a few slight issues with tolerancing on the encoder gaps. So this is the actuator that powers the joints in our exoskeleton. It is powered by an electric motor and driven by a ball screw transmission with a linkage system. On the output, we have a magnetic encoder here provided by RLS. It is a non-interference magnetic encoder, and in the drawing here, you can see the reed head and the specified gap. It should be about 0.35 millimeters.
This is the reed head for the encoder, and it sits off of right around here, some rotation. This board was too close to the ring, so it's pressing against it. So as this rotated, this output rotated this way, the reed head would rub on the ring. You can see like a rubbed area and then a pile of the magnet ring.
Why is that important?
Well, there's supposed to be a specific distance between this reed head and this ring. I don't know, a few thousandths of an inch. That's pretty precise. And if it's off, if it's too far away, it won't work. And if it's too close, well, it won't work. In addition to, it'll wear away the ring. So the ring encodes the position of the output. So in this ring are magnets that are very specifically arranged. So when this reed head sees those magnets, it knows exactly the rotation of this ring. So now that this is damaged, it's not gonna work. So I have to pop this ring out. Since we only use 120 degrees of the rotation, I can rotate it about 180, and now I get a good portion of the ring.
And we also had a few small issues with our motor locks. So when designing a component via CAD, it's always expected that when you begin to manufacture it and begin to see what processes you're going to use to make the components, you're going to have a little bit of tolerance errors, and you'll have to understand your processes and work through that to make sure you can get all of your components to fit properly. So here on the Quix project, we have all of the different portions of the exoskeleton. There's Vishnu, who's been working on the fabrication and design of the feet. Brandon has been working on the user interface and the crutch. I've been working on the mechanical design and all of the structural components. Mark's been doing all of the carbon fiber fabrication. He's been prepping the molds, prepping all of the carbon materials and doing the bagging. And Travis has been doing the electronics and wiring.
So what are these?
So these are the pressure sensors that are going to into the foot. And I've connected all the pressure sensors to a multiplexer. And from the multiplexer, I'm going to connect it to the Arduino. So once I start loading the pressure sensors, I should be able to see the reading of the pressure sensors in terms of force. And based on the particular force value, we can find the center of pressure and the other details when you're walking, or like when the toe is off or when the heel is down. So I've been working on that, and so this is the force value that we are finding from the pressure sensors. Mm-hmm. And right now I've loaded the third sensor, so I'm able to see the value in the third row.
So what does that piece of tape do?
So what happens is that those two LEDs are close to each other. So when the e-stop is turned off, you're able to see when it is turned off, you should be able to see green light, but due to the interference between those two LEDs, we are not able to see a clear green light. So that's why we are taping the other LED so that we can make sure that the e-stopper is on or off.
So our current crutch uses a wired connection, which means we're constantly tethered to the device, and we have this big bulky screen.
So we're trying to improve that by moving to a smaller screen and wireless data communication. Here I'm just prototyping what will eventually be embedded in the crutch, and the whole design of where everything's gonna go in the crutch is what Tomas is working on right now. So we have a similar layout to the previous design. So we still have three buttons for scrolling through different options, confirming an action, and then we have, again, a single button dedicated to triggering movement. So there's only one button that you can click that will make the device move, which is kind of what Mark's used to. And then this is the wireless communication device. It's called an XP. So there'll be one of these in the crutch, and then another one housed in the backpack somewhere. Also have a vibration motor taped to the back here, so that we can get some vibration feedback for the user. And we decided that if I don't get this working in 2 weeks, then we're gonna throw it in the trash and go back to previous design, just because we're hurting for time, and so if I can't get it working, we're just gonna use this working solution. The only downside is that we have this tethered data connection. On the previous exoskeleton, we were kind of sloppy with how we did the computer and the whole backpack setup. There's a lot of excess space, excess wires, so on this iteration, we decided that we would make it a lot more compact, try and clean it all up, and go about it a little bit more professionally. So Travis, our electrical engineer, has been working very closely with me to create these battery packs as well as an enclosure to house all of the electronics, computer boards, all of those things.
All right, so show me what do we got there.
So this is the new Quix exoskeleton backpack. It will house the computer electronics. It will have a few status lights to tell us what mode the robot's in, and it will also hold the battery packs here on the sides. To open it, you release the knob and turn it. That opens it to give access to all of the computer stuff. You just push to close, push the knob back in so that it's hidden. The battery pack is very similar to just a cordless drill. You slide it on. And it just locks in place. To release it, there's a button here. Grab it and pull up. It comes off. Here on the battery pack mount, there's a contact protector to make sure you can't get your fingers in there.
Yeah, I'm working on the pressure sensor feed, so we can tell where our center of pressure is when Mark is standing in the exo.
What are we looking at?
This is the sensor boards for the feet. So each of these little nubs are pressure sensors, and they will have a little dome on them for that actually contact the ground, and we'll transfer that pressure up into the sensor. This is the toe section. This is the kind of the back, the rest of the foot, essentially. And then we have a small section of flex where we can have the board flex around so you're not bending the board itself. So China right now is dealing with the COVID-19 virus. All of our board manufacturers for our circuit boards are in China. all of the factories are either delayed or still closed because of COVID-19 virus. So I have outstanding orders that aren't getting made yet because they don't know when they're going to open back up. So I got to find a new place to get our boards and stuff made, which is not super fun. It's China makes everything right now.